Financial Times for over a decade, both in China, Brazil, the United Kingdom, and now in the United States. He was the Financial Times bureau chief in Beijing from 2008 to 2011, and also worked in Shanghai briefly before that. He's also been the paper's Brazil bureau chief and has covered the healthcare industry, and he's worked extensively on the AIDS epidemic in Africa and Asia. Most recently, in 2012, he has taken up a position in Washington, D.C., where he is covering American foreign policy for the Financial Times. His book, which we're here to discuss today, which is based on years of research and personal experience in China, is entitled The Contest of the Century, The New Era of Competition with China and How America Can Win. In the book, Geoff offers an in-depth analysis of Chinese foreign policymaking and the challenges that confront China's leaders as they seek to turn the country into a global power. The book has received plenty of critical acclaim. Professor Min-Hsin Pei has said that the contest of the century has definitely set a new and more demanding standard for books on Chinese foreign policy. The New York Review of Books describes his work as fascinating, stimulating, and deeply researched, perfectly timed to explain the unfolding conflicts in East Asia. And Robert Kaplan writes, this one I thought was a little funnier, he writes, "The contest of the century is a perfect antidote to all the noise that passes for journalism these days." So Robert Kaplan apparently has something against journalists, but he loves Geoff Dyer, and he says, "Here is a seasoned foreign correspondent calmly taking the measure of Asia's pivotal giant." And with that, so please join me in welcoming Geoff Dyer to explain the contest of the century.
Well, good afternoon, good evening. Thank you very much to the Wilson School for inviting me here today. It's a huge pleasure to be here today. It's an honor, really, to be invited to speak at somewhere like this. It's also a real thrill for me personally. One of the great things about publishing this book is it's given me a chance to visit all these places around the country that I've never had a chance to visit before. So it's really sort of personally very gratifying to be asked to come here and speak here today. It's also very nice personally to get a chance to be talking again about China. As I mentioned, I moved to the US a couple of years ago, and I have this remit for the newspaper where I was writing about American foreign policy. And when I moved here, I thought, well, I'll be doing, 40% will be about Asia, and 40% will be about Middle East, and 20% about the rest of the world. And then at some stage last year, I nearly changed my business card to the Middle East correspondent, because that's really what sucks all the oxygen out of the room in Washington these days and most days. There is this old Washington adage that the urgent always beats out the important. There are always fires around the world, and that's often what Washington is focused on. But ultimately, that's really the important things that all should be trying to focus on, and what's happening in China, and how the US reacts to that, and how China and the US get on together or not over the next couple of decades, is, with all due respect to everything that's going on in the Middle East, is going to be more important to what the world looks like and how many people's lives are lived than what's going on in the Middle East. And also, if I just put a little apology, my apologies, my voice is a little scratchy. I've got a bit of a bug. I have a two-year-old son, and this is probably something that for the students there I have absolutely no interest in knowing about, but two-year-olds are basically little walking buffets of viruses. I think that's the way to think about them. I mean, the son goes off to his little school every morning and plays with his little friends and comes back every day with a new selection of bugs for my wife and I to choose from. So, but anyway, I apologize if my voice is a little scratchy. But I have two sort of broad propositions that I'd like to put forward to you this afternoon. The first is that I would say we're entering into what I describe as a new era of geopolitical competition. Over the last few years, China has changed gears in a very important way. It wants to start shaping the world more towards its interests. And that means that the US and China, in all sorts of ways, little and some big, are going to be butting up against each other in the years ahead. If we've lived for the last couple of decades through an era that you might call one of Davos globalization, when we're told that the world was flat, well, all that process will still be in place, but we're also going to have something different with much harder edges that's going to be pulling us in a different direction. Russia is a small part of that story, but I think China is really the much bigger and more important, more valuable part of that story. And then the second proposition that I like to put forward is that actually China's going to find it very hard to dislodge the US. The US has huge inbuilt advantages in its position in the world today, and it still has a very good chance, if it plays its card right, to retain a position both as a more dominant power in Asia Pacific and in the world more broadly. So the one way to think about it is, I'm the guy who went to China and came away believing in the US. That's not the story you've heard about China from most people in the last decade, but that's, in the odd way, that's where I've ended up coming out. So let's start with my first proposition. This idea that China has really changed from being, if you like, a rule taker to a rule maker. And this really started to become apparent to me in the years I was living in Beijing. I was there for a very sort of turbulent time. It was the 2008 Olympics. You had the global financial crisis. And you could feel viscerally that something was starting to change within the country, that the emotional temperature was starting to change a bit. And in some ways, the key moment for me happened on October the 1st, 2009. And that was the day of the 60th anniversary of the People's Republic of China. And the Communist Party held this huge grand parade in central Beijing to commemorate the event. Closed off the whole center of the city, and then closed off all of Tiananmen Square. And this parade came along the main avenue in Beijing, Tiananmen. And you had long lines of tanks, of soldiers, and these huge missiles that China's been developing, all parading through Beijing's main street. And over the course of that 2 or 3 hours, you had 200,000 people took part in this parade, and not a single person put a foot wrong. It was a display that I described it combined some North Korean mass choreography with the kind of swagger that we sometimes used to see from the Soviet Union during their May Day parades. And you got the sense of this country that was starting to bristle with pride, and it just felt different. And as a journalist or academic, you can understand the country through reading books and interviews and traveling and talking. But sometimes it's spectacles like that that make you see what actually was right in front of your eyes and you hadn't quite realized. And what I began to slowly realize, what China was undergoing, what I describe as a big decisive shift in the way that it thinks about its role in the world. For 30 years after Mao died, China really kept its head down and it concentrated on growing its economy, developing its society, and boosting the living standards of ordinary people. But now it's making this historic shift towards a country that wants to start shaping the world more to its own ends, so it's run more towards Chinese interests. It's starting to channel what I describe as its inner great power. You know, we tend to talk so much about a rising China. That's the phrase people always use to describe it, so rising China. And there's still probably a lot more of that to come. But in important ways, China now has already risen. I think that's the key point we want to try and get across. There was this great Henry Kissinger quote when he's talking about the US in the 1890s, and he described it, he said, "No nation has ever experienced such an increase in its economic power without seeking to translate that into global influence." And in some ways, that's now the moment, that's the parallel that China has now reached. It's a comparison, if you like, with the 1890s, 1900s in the US, the Teddy Roosevelt era. It's a country that's now trying to come into its own onto the international stage. Now, maybe it doesn't want to push that comparison too far. I mean, the US did then go on to invade Cuba and the Philippines. I'm not necessarily suggesting that that's what China immediately has in mind. But this broader sense of this has been, this last few years have been something of a coming of age moment for China when it wants to start spreading its wings. So one question from that is, why is this happening and why now? Well, I think the financial crisis was a hugely important trigger in all of this. It unleashed something quite powerful from within the psyche of the Chinese elite. There had always been this argument in Beijing, within the Communist Party, and within intellectuals in China, about how China would behave when it became powerful. The hawks, if you like, within China would say, is ultimately we're going to need to challenge the US because the world is run along US lines, and if we want to be more influential, we're going to have to push back in important ways against the US. And the doves in China said, no, actually, Chinese interests will best be served by integrating ourselves into the global economy and the global system that US has helped forge, and that's the way that we can expand our economy, expand our influence, and expand our well-being. And that has always been an important argument in Beijing. But it was always an argument about the future. It was about a theoretical argument about what we'll do one day in the future when we become powerful. Well, the financial crisis really changed the dynamic of that. What happened was essentially the hawks within China said, you know what? Now is the moment when we need to start answering this question. Now is our time. America's in decline, and this is our moment to make our push. And that's not to say that, you know, the hawks necessarily won the argument, but just that the financial crisis brought it from being something that was theoretical and abstract being something that is very much about the now and the present in Chinese political life. Now, and within that is this idea wrapped up that the US is now in decline. This was a very powerful motion, especially at the height of the financial crisis in 08 and 09, but it hasn't necessarily dissipated even though the US economy has come back. It's not that China buys into this idea that President Obama is somehow weak and feckless and we can push him around. It's not so much that, but it's more they see the American system and they look at gridlock in Congress, and government shutdowns, and inability of the executive to really get a lot of things done. And they do look at the US and think that, you know, this is still a country that's going to have big problems, and you know, the initiative is still with us. That's one way to think about this moment in China's history. Another one is to think about it in just in terms of size and scale. China's been invested very heavily in its military for the last two decades. It's increased military spending almost every year for 20 years at over 10% a year. Now, if you increase something by 10% a year, you end up, even if you start at a small place, you end up with something quite substantial. Just, it's the geopolitics of compound arithmetic. It's just that's the way things work. And over the course of 20 years, the Chinese military has now grown by a factor of 5 times. And so it's fairly inevitable that you get people within the system in China saying, well, now we have this military muscle, we have this weight, we should start to use it in certain ways to push our own interests. So to some extent, one of the reasons why China is now starting to throw its weight around is for no other reason than it now can. I think you also need to think about China in terms of the expansive interests that it has slowly accumulated over this 20 or 30 years of rapid economic growth. Now, when you think about what makes the Chinese economy tick every day, well, it's now relying on iron ore from Brazil, copper from the Congo, oil from Sudan, and coal from Indonesia. All these raw materials and commodities coming from all around the world that it requires a constant supply of every day to keep this economic machine ticking along. So that means that China no longer has the luxury of sitting back and letting the world run its own affairs. If it wants to keep its economy humming, and if it wants to protect those developing interests that have evolved, it needs in important ways to start trying to shape the global economy. A further feature or thing that's happened really in the last decade are subtle shifts within the way that power is exerted within China, within the Chinese political system. Part of that is pressure from below for the leadership. That the popular nationalism, the kind of raucous nationalism that you've started to really kind of flourish in the last decade, especially on the internet, which is violently anti-Japanese, but also very, very skeptical about the US. In the first week I moved to Shanghai in 2005, we rented an apartment on the main street in Shanghai, Wahoo, and we came out of our apartment on Saturday morning, and there was this huge demonstration really going down this main street. There were between 15 and 20,000 people taking part in what was in some ways the biggest demonstration since Tiananmen Square in 1989. And it was all a demonstration against Japan, and there was all young Chinese students who were shouting very, very nasty slogans about Japan. Then when they walked past Japanese restaurants or shops that had Japanese script, they would throw paint and throw bottles. And the police, by and large, just stood by and laughed and let this go on. It was a very, very peculiar event. And what you started to get the sense was both it was with a government that doesn't want to be seen to be weak in front of these kind of nationalist pressures, and also a sense that at the margins, sometimes emotion is beginning to take a stronger, play a stronger role in the way that China thinks about some of these issues, especially to do with its neighbors, especially to do with Japan, but also more broadly about its role in the world. And then from within the system, there have also been important new pressures, particularly, I think, from the military. And for China watchers, trying to understand where the military ends and the Communist Party starts and how that relationship all works out is probably one of the hardest things there is. It's very much a black box. But the snippets of information that we have been able to get in the last few years do suggest a military that's a bit more restive. It also has a very, very skeptical worldview about some of its neighbors and about the US and the role of the US military. And it's slowly and surely pushing the leadership to take a slightly more, not confrontational, but more assertive stance. And again, you get a sense of the leadership that doesn't necessarily feel it can push back against these growing interests within the system. And then all of that brings us to, you know, the new Chinese leader, Xi Jinping, who a lot of people think he's the person who's actually been the one who's really pushing a lot of this new stance in Chinese foreign policy, this more assertive stance. And I think that's a bit of an exaggeration. Lots of these things were already baked into the system before he took power. Many of them have long roots, but they really started to pick up, I think, a few years before he took power. But in lots of ways, he does personally encapsulate them in some of the ways. He very much has strong roots within the military. His father was a be a very famous revolutionary general. His first job was as a personal assistant to the Minister of Defense. He used to wear his uniform to office every day. He was very proud of his connection to the military. And as he built his career as a provincial official traveling around the country in China, at every stage in his career, he always stuck very close to the military people. They've always been part of his support base. And his wife has the rank of Major General within the PLA. She's actually a very famous folk singer and has built her career in a cultural troupe attached to the PLA. And so you have all these different trends and they're beginning to bubble up, and then you have this new leader who takes on that in some ways personalizes and can articulate some of those changes. And so one of the key questions I think of China over the next decade is the extent to which Xi Jinping is a person who has the credibility to push back against the military, or is actually someone who's going to channel some of their more skeptical instincts. The result of all these different subtle shifts within the way China thinks about its role in the world is going to be, I think, an era of much stronger, tougher competition with the US. Really, since the end of World War II, the world has been run along rules and institutions and values and money that was established by the United States. And now China is starting to challenge that. It's starting to say we want to have our say, we want things to be more reflect some of our interests. And the three very specific ways which you're starting to see this kind of geopolitical competition play out. First is directly in this military sphere that I was talking about. China is slowly and surely beginning to contest the control that the US has exerted over the Western Pacific for the last 60 years. Essentially, the Western Pacific, the US Navy began to think of it almost as a private lake. And China is slowly and surely beginning to push back against that. I mentioned that China had increased military spending by 10% a year for the last 20 years. Within that, the Navy has been given pride of place. It's very much a lot of the resources have been pushed towards the Navy. But also, there's another bit of that story that is not just about the Navy. There's a whole part of the Chinese military is what American analysts sometimes call an anti-Navy. And what they mean by that is the complex of very sophisticated missiles, some based at sea, some based on land, that China has developed over the last couple of decades that are specifically directed American ships, American submarines, and in one case, potentially at American aircraft carriers. And so when you read all these stories about complicated squabbles, about unused, deserted islands in the East China Sea and the South China Sea, well, that's part of this broader push, this broader idea of an incremental push by the Chinese to slowly gain more control over the seas that surround it in the East China Sea and the South China Sea. Gaining more influence over its neighbors, and in the process slowly pushing the US Navy further out into the Western Pacific. And that's incredibly important. It might sound abstract and slightly obscure, but it has very important long-term implications, because if China can convince its neighbors that they can no longer rely on the security guarantees that the US has offered them, if it's able to do that, if it's able to push the US further out to sea into the Western Pacific, then it'll start to have much more influence over the rules, the economic rules, the trade rules, the business practices in the Asia Pacific, and the Asia Pacific being the most dynamic and most important and fast-growing bit of the world economy. So within that military push to alter the balance of power in Asia, it has very important long-term implications of the way that business and economics and trade are run, and potentially politics as well. I'll briefly tell you another couple of ways in which this new sort of more assertive China is demonstrating itself. Another is in the currency. The way that China is now trying to build up the renminbi into the kind of international currency that will be able to challenge the dominance of the US dollar. China's conducting all sorts of experiments in Hong Kong to find ways to encourage people to start holding the renminbi, to invest in the renminbi, to trade in the renminbi. And that has big advantages for Chinese business. If trade and investment was conducted in the Chinese currency and not in the American currency, there would be big cost advantages for Chinese companies. But underlying that is a big political motivation. Chinese are very jealous of the underlying economic power that the role of the dollar gives the US, and they want to slowly start chipping away at that. And then finally is an area of soft power as well. It's another area where China has become much more ambitious in the last few years. China's trying to, in a sense, challenge the hold that both US companies and more American values have in the media industry, particularly in the media industry around the world. Is investing a lot of money in its own media companies, and also challenges CNNs and the BBCs and the New York Timeses of this world. And just to give you one example of the scale of the ambition that China has, and this is just small anecdote, but it gives you some sense of it. If you go to Times Square now, if you go to the 47th and Broadway, the corner there, it's that very famous shop that has some of the most famous neon advertising hoardings in the world. If you go to that point now, there are a million tourists a day pass by there. You will see four different brands advertised. You'll see Coca-Cola, the most famous brand in the world, HSBC, one of the biggest banks in the world, Samsung, the biggest mobile phone company in the world, and the Xinhua News Agency. Now, just having an advert in Times Square doesn't necessarily mean anything, but it does give you a scale of ambition that China has for these media companies that it's trying to take overseas. Just to conclude on this first point, I don't want to overstate this whole idea of geopolitical competition. This is not a story about red China trying to dominate the world or anything like that. This is not a rerun of the Cold War in any means. This is really a return to a different pattern of international relations, a slightly older one, which students of the 19th century would be more familiar with. It's about competition between great powers. This is how big, important countries do tend to behave. They jostle and they push and they nudge. And unfortunately, they do sometimes fight each other for power and influence. And this is the kind of pattern that we're going to start to see. It shouldn't come as a surprise to us that China's thinking this way. This is a very natural way for inspiring great power to behave. But it's very much more, it's not a struggle, it's more of a chessboard than a struggle. That's why I call it the contest of the century. This is not in any way a rerun of the Cold War and that kind of do to the death type of struggle. So then on to my second major contention, the idea that actually, even though China has these ambitions that are now beginning to take shape, it has these aspirations to play a much bigger role in the world, it's actually going to find it very hard to topple the US. I think one way to think about that is to look back at this whole idea of military competition in the Asia-Pacific, which is the hottest bit of this emerging rivalry. And there are two big points I want to make. The first one is that when you look at Asia today, it's wrong to think of Asia as just a story about China rising. Actually, there are a whole series of countries in Asia today that are rising. There are also proud, dynamic countries that also think that this is their time. You have a country like South Korea, which is in lots of ways the absolute success story of the last 40 years, one of the most dynamic, impressive countries in the world. Indonesia is coming into its own. Vietnam has been growing very strongly. And then further around the continent, you also have that other 1 billion person country that also thinks that this is going to be its century, India. So the broader, and then even you have Japan, which is still, one has to keep reminding people, still is the third biggest economy in the world. And maybe is beginning to come out of that 20-year slump. The broad picture of that is that you have a very crowded neighborhood. It's not just about China beginning to assert itself. There are lots of other countries that also want to have a say. And so that's going to make it much harder for China to really assert itself, to become dominant. And the second thing to bear in mind is just the huge amount of opposition that has been generated by China towards itself. The phrase I like to frame this is to say, this is not about the pivot, it's about the backlash. In the US, people often like to frame things about what the US policy is and what the Obama administration is doing, and frame all this about the Obama administration's supposed pivot to the US, where they're going to increase their influence and their presence in the region. But that's not really the very important story. The most important thing that's happened in Asia in the last 5 years is the very powerful resentment that China has managed to generate to itself by its neighbors. Lots of Asian countries around China are starting to get properly freaked out about what a powerful and important China would start to mean for them. This is not a story about the US imposing itself on Asia against its will. This is about Asian countries imploring the US to become more involved, to balance against China. If this was just a story about the US against China, then the US would lose. If for no other reason than geography, it's China is right there in the heart of the Asia Pacific and the US is 8,000 miles away. But the big advantage that the US has is that most of these other Asian countries want exactly the same things that the US wants. They want free trade that goes across the Pacific, not just within Asia. They want freedom of navigation. And they want a dispute system that can be solved along rules and not just in terms of might makes right. And so for all those reasons, they're very, very nervous about what a powerful China will mean for them. And there are a couple of examples I'll give just to explain how this backlash has played out over the last few years. One of the most important ones is obviously Japan. hard even for Japan watchers to remember this, but even 5 years ago, there was a very strong anti-American sentiment in Japan. In 2009, a man called Yuko Hatoyama was elected prime minister, and he came into office with an agenda of setting up a whole new set of geopolitical arrangements in Asia, which would involve Japan getting much closer to China, and in subtle ways, cutting out the US. And he was part of a whole generation of politicians who came to age during sort of anti-Vietnam War protests, and reflected that sort of lingering anti-American sentiment that has always been present in Japanese politics. A year later, the man behind the throne in that new government, Ichiro Ozawa, took a group of 143 lawmakers to Beijing on this trip to China. And they went to the Great Hall of the People, and they met Hu Jintao. And Hu Jintao took a photograph and shook hands with every single one of those 143 Japanese politicians. And it really was this very symbolic moment of you could tell Japan starting to shift its allegiance, starting to defer much more to China, and starting to feel much less reliant on the US. And that was a real, very, very important moment. And in some ways, the US-Japan alliance looked as if it was more vulnerable than it had looked at any time since the Second World War, even during those very intense economic trade disputes of the 1980s. But rather than take that opportunity to drive a further wedge between the US and Japan, China's ended up doing the opposite. In the years since then, there have been a whole series of very tense disputes, particularly about the Senkaku Diaoyu Islands in the East China Sea. And the result of all these disputes, where China has pushed its claims very aggressively and very firmly, has been to turn an entire Japanese political elite against China, and Japanese public opinion as well. So if you now go to take opinion polls, both in Japan and China, the latest polls show that in Japan, only 8% of people trust China. And in China, the numbers are even lower, 5 or 6% of people trust Japan. China lost the opportunity the moment that it might have had to try and cleave Japan away from its alliance to the US, to try and drive a wedge between the two allies in a way that would have enhanced its influence. It's really lost its chance to influence Japanese politics for at least a generation. And it could tell a similar story about other countries in the region. If you take a country like South Korea, 10 years ago as well, South Korean politics was consumed by a very strong anti-American feeling. Many of you will be familiar with the rapper Psy, the Gangnam Style guy, who had all the most famous, the most viewed YouTube video of all time. Well, in the early 2000s, he articulated very much that part of his whole pitch was this anti-American sentiment. During his concerts, he would put an American tank on stage and smash it up in front of the crowd. And the lyrics to one of his songs went, "Kill those Yankees who've been torturing Iraqi captives. Kill those Yankees who ordered them to torture." So again, this is a real moment where you could feel potentially the long-standing alliance that the US has with South Korea beginning to fracture with this popular sentiment against the US. But over the course of the last decade, again, China slightly dropped the ball, has missed the opportunity, because it's been seen in North Korea to be indulging, it's seen in the South as if it's been indulging North Korea and its ever more eccentric behavior. It's managed to push South Korea back towards the US so that the US-South Korean relationship is actually as strong as it's been for a number of years. In the Philippines, a similar story. In 2007, the president of the Philippines, Gloria Arroyo, she famously said that we're very happy to have China as our big brother. Fast forward to last year, and the new Filipino president, Benigno Aquino, he describes China essentially as Nazis. He described China as fascists. So the Philippines is another country where opinion has shifted absolutely dramatically against China over the last 4 or 5 years. And one of the big takeaways from that, I think, is as well as the sort of strategic implications of that, is that when we look at China, a lot of China watchers, they tend to fetishize China to some extent. You can see that in some of the sort of Henry Kissinger type analysis of China. They tend to say, well, this country has got this deep millennial culture. They're very sophisticated. They're very wise. They understand the way that power works. And here, we in the US, we're so short-termist. We're so narrow. We have Congress. We can't really get anything going. Well, it turns out that China can also make major strategic blunders. I mean, if there's one thing we want to take over this, that China can also get things dramatically wrong. And over the last 5 years in Asia, they have done that. To say a little bit about soft power as well, why China's going to struggle very much on this front. Soft power, this idea that the way you can influence countries is not just through your checkbook or through your military, but also through your attractiveness, the idea that you have a culture and a civilization, if you like, that is very attractive to other countries, and they will start to bend more towards your will if they want to emulate you in certain ways. Now, China's been doing that very aggressively through its media investments. It did that a lot through the Olympics, was almost the high point of the Chinese soft power push. And the day before the Olympics, the deputy director of the opening ceremony, that grand spectacle they put on that captured so many people's imaginations around the world, he described the objective as the following. He said, we want people to love China, we want people to desire China. And that was the real drive, that China's spending all this money, trying to change the impression, the ideas that people have about China, to have it seen in a more positive light. But ultimately, I think that's going to be very hard to do, because I think China misunderstands the nature of soft power. China sees it as a sort of bureaucratic project, kind of top-down initiative that the government can run. It throws money at soft power in the way that it might do trying to create an industry for wind power or for nuclear turbines or for airplanes. But that's not how soft power works. Soft power is generated from below. It's generated from society. It's generated from the dynamism and creativity of a country's own citizens. And many of those people, precisely the people who might change the way the world thinks about China, are the people who get caught in the crosshairs of the way the Chinese political system does work. I'm talking about, you know, the Ai Weiwei's of this world, the artist Ai Weiwei, or someone like Liu Xiaobo, the literature professor and activist who won the Nobel Peace Prize a few years ago. And in a way, China hopes that it can use soft power to slightly change the way that people think about the Chinese political system. But actually, it's the Chinese political system that is stopping it from actually generating soft power. And the best example I have of that is actually the filmmaker Zhang Yimou. Zhang Yimou is not like Ai Weiwei or Liu Xiaobo. He's not like a dissident. In fact, he's in many ways, he is the Chinese court artist. He is of the creative class of people. He is the person the Communist Party feels most confidence in. So that he was the man who was chosen to be the director for the opening ceremony of the 2008 Olympics. And I once got to interview Zhang Yimou and ask him why it was that all his films seemed to be period pieces. They were all about history and the past. He never made films about present-day China. And that seemed to be very important, because even though China does have this very rigid, almost Leninist political system, below that today, Chinese society is exploding. It's creative and dynamic and interesting. And if you wanted to change the view that people have about China, the world, Zhang Yimou films that give a sense of this complexity and subtlety be one of the perfect ways to do that. So I asked him, why don't you make films about present-day China? And he said to me quite bluntly, he said, if I did that, then the censors would make my life so unpleasant, it just wouldn't be worth my while. Now, this is not some rabid dissident. This is the sort of the Chinese court artist, and even he doesn't really want to get into these type of subjects because he just thinks it would be too much trouble. So I'll close on a couple of final comments because my time is running out. I don't want to give the impression that this is going to be something cakewalk for the US, that this Chinese challenge is going to be something very easy for the US to deflect. Actually, I think it raises some very profound questions about how the US thinks about itself. And there could be a number of very important things that the US is going to have to do if it is going to be able to absorb and deflect this Chinese push to become more powerful in the world. The first is to say quite bluntly that in this military sphere, South China Sea, the East China Sea, the US is now facing a very complicated test of wills, of resolve over the next decade or so. And it has to find the right way to push back against some of these Chinese moves, but not in ways that seem overly confrontational or overly aggressive, and which will attract counter moves, and where the US will get blamed for being the destabilizing power. That's actually, sounds quite simple, sounds quite obvious, but it's very, very hard to do. Some of these Chinese moves are very subtle, they're very gradual, they're very incremental. In journalistic parlance, it's a below-the-fold strategy. China's doing things in ways that it will not actually attract a lot of immediate attention, but accumulated over a period of time will have a big influence. And the Obama administration has been really struggling with this, and it hasn't quite found a way to push back in a way that's decisive and firm, but not too aggressive. And that's going to be a very hard battle for the US, I think, over the coming years. The second thing is that what China really poses for the US is an issue of having to set priorities. I live in Washington, D.C., and on any given day in Washington, D.C., I can go to hear someone speak and say that their issue their place in the world is absolutely a Central American national security interest. It could be anything from around the world. And for a number of years, because the US was so much more powerful than anyone else in the world, it was able to have that luxury of thinking in those terms. But now that it does have a real peer competitor, it does have to prioritize much more and ask difficult questions about what are the things that are really important to us, what do we really want to achieve, and what are the things we're not quite so interested in, and have a much stronger sense of priorities, and so that it's able to actually apply resources to the places that it really is interested in and not apply to the places that it's only partly interested in. Again, that sounds so very obvious, but it's an incredibly hard thing for a country to do in any political system, and the American political system doesn't necessarily make that any easier. And within that, it also requires a very disciplined diplomacy, I think. One of the things that Hillary Clinton was fantastic at in Asia was that she went everywhere. Whatever the diplomatic meeting was in Asia, it could be something unbelievably dull and tedious. Hillary Clinton was there, she made her presence felt, and that had a very powerful effect because it made people in the region see that she took Asia as being very important. It made people in the region see that the US thought that Asia was a top priority, and it has a powerful psychological impact. Since she left office, lots of things have been going on in the world, in Russia, in the Middle East, and the administration has dropped that a bit. The president has had to cancel a trip to the region. John Kerry has been very focused on the Middle East peace process, on Iran, and all sorts of things in the Middle East. And they've already managed to drop the ball in that sense. But that's very, very important. Just the sense of disciplined participation and constant presence is always necessary to make people in the region think that the US still cares. And then finally, almost the hardest thing, is the US needs to change the way it both talks and thinks about the Asia-Pacific in economic terms. Shortly after I moved to the country, we had the 2012 presidential campaign, and you'll remember that Barack Obama and Mitt Romney were going around the country, they were going around Ohio talking about Chinese cheaters. Well, that wasn't just offensive to people in China, that was actually offensive to people across Asia. They saw the arguments about Chinese cheaters, and they thought this is an America that's withdrawing from globalization, that's much less confident about its place in the world, and is not going to be so present in the global economy. But actually, Asia-Pacific is going to be absolutely fundamental to the future of the American economy. Any politician's country these days will give you an argument saying that the thing that we need are more genuine middle-class jobs. We need to revive middle-class, and that's only going to happen through reviving manufacturing and services that can be sold abroad through exporting these types of goods. And where are you going to export them to? A lot of it is going to have to be the fast-growing dynamic markets in Asia-Pacific. It's not going to happen unless the US can increase its presence in those markets. Again, that seems like economic logic, but that's a very hard message for an American politician to put forward at the moment. There is this deep-seated sense that globalization has been a trap for the US, that that's responsible for a lot of the problems that people feel in their daily lives. So it's very hard for American politicians to make that message to American audiences. They say it when they go to Asia, but they don't say it in Ohio or Michigan or any of the other states when they're campaigning in this country. But that's what is ultimately is going to be needed. If the US wants to remain relevant in Asia Pacific, it wants to be able to push back against this Chinese push, then it's going to be able to offer something more than just a few aircraft carriers that come in when things get tough. It's going to have a much better economic story about how it sees its future as being intricately linked to the future of the Asia Pacific. Anyway, I'm going to leave it here because I've run over time already, but I'd now like to open it up to hear all your questions, comments, criticisms, abuse, whatever it is you like, please, I'd very much like to hear from you. Thank you very much.
To look to the US as being a very significant and clear strategic mistake. And I'd be curious if you think that China sees it that way, and if they're likely to try and undo that
that's a very good question. I think two ways I'd answer that. One is to say that China, in a sense, actually has two, the way China would describe it, they have a sense of two foreign policies. They have this military strategy that I've described, which is about building up this set of missiles, and building up the Navy, setting up a series of capacities that can push the US further out to sea so that they can become more powerful in the region. Their diplomatic strategy is actually the complete opposite, is to say we want to build up very strong relationships with our neighbors because we realize that we need to insert ourselves into the global economy to boost our exports, and the way to do that is to have good, peace and stability in our surroundings and have strong relationships with our neighbors. So in a sense, you have two contrasting strategies. Underlying that, I think, though, is a very, what I describe as an instinct, a very powerful instinct that China has, which is that they ultimately think that their historical place is to be the dominant power in Asia. That's the way they understand their history, that's the way they understand the region, that's the way they understand their sense of China's role in the world. And so even though intellectually they know that they're making lots of mistakes and tripping up over themselves, at their hearts they ultimately think that this is the rightful place for them to be dominant in Asia, and ultimately that the rest of the region will accept that. And that's where I think they're making a mistake. That's the really big mistake they're making. Ultimately, they think that if they were able to displace the US, that they would simply just replace the US and become the sort of benign hegemon that everyone defers to. And I don't think that's the way it will play out, even if they were able to actually push the US further out. Ultimately, you'd have is a much more angry, resentful Asia. You'd have a nuclear Japan, you'd have a South Korea, very, very worried, maybe a nuclear Vietnam. You'd have a whole series of countries just sitting there building up their own deterrence and waiting for China to slip up, and so you have a much more unstable region. So I think that ultimately they're making a very big mistake in thinking that they can displace the US in a painless way. I don't know if that answers your question properly.
Thank you.
So now, following on that point, you mentioned the 1 billion people population in India.
Yes.
And it's really growing. So India, Japan, South Korea, these countries, will they be able to really compete with China with the equal force? And second part is that because of China's one-child policy, as I understand, their younger population is going down, and they're getting much and much older like Japan. How will that affect their economic growth?
Your first question about India and these other countries. India is a very interesting example. The US made this opening towards India during the Bush administration. And in a sense, one way to think about that was almost to think of it as the first step in the US pivot to Asia, because part of that thinking was that we'll have a much better relationship with India, and eventually they'll become a partner of ours in balancing against China. Now, at the moment and for the foreseeable future, that's going to fail. The last thing that India wants is to be seen as an American junior partner in an Asian organization to contain China. India has a very proud, not just a non-alignment tradition, but also has a proud sense of its own independence. It wants to be its own actor. It doesn't want to be an American lackey, sort of play the role that Britain has played beside America. And so for the time being, those American aspirations that India will be this viable partner are going to be disappointed. But I think the key thing over the next decade or so is what China starts to do in the Indian Ocean. The Chinese Navy has been mostly focused on the South China Sea and the East China Sea. But it started to spread its influence a bit into the Indian Ocean because it's, if you think about the Chinese economy, all this oil that comes down from the Middle East comes through the Indian Ocean. And so if you want to control your destiny and be able to prevent someone from blockading you, you need to have a presence in the Indian Ocean. And so you started to see these possible ideas about maybe China would have a naval base in Sri Lanka, or maybe it'd have a naval base in Pakistan. It has a very close relationship with Pakistan. Now, all those things are way off in the future. I mean, they'll take a decade or two for those things to play out. But if China does move in a decisive way into the Indian Ocean, and if China was to have a naval base, for instance, in Pakistan, then I think you would see a very decisive shift in the way that India thought about itself, and it would push India much closer towards the US. And that kind of partnership that people were thinking about even a decade ago in the Bush administration would start to become more of a reality. Second question about the one-child policy. So clearly, you know, this is starting to have an effect on China. China's already hitting this demographic bulge, if you like, where there's a shrinking number of people coming into the workforce, it doesn't have that cheap labor that it's been able to rely on for the last couple of decades that was giving it this big productivity push. But people, I think, maybe slightly exaggerate the reality of the one-child policy. For most people in China, it hasn't really been a reality for quite a long time. In rural areas, there are lots of dispensations for certain ethnic groups. There are dispensations if you come from a family where you're an only child and your spouse is an only child, there are dispensations. And there have been further relaxations along the way. So in a sense, even though we call it the one-child policy, for a lot of people in China, it's been the two-child policy for the last few years. And there are ways in which it can be and will be further relaxed without necessarily giving up completely on that big bureaucracy they've created. But it will be lots of incremental ways in which it will be relaxed, in which some of those demographic effects will be reduced.
It's a long-term approach, really. It will take a long time.
Demographics is all about long term. It's about these curves shifting over decades. You know, it's not something that you'll ever see in 1 month or 1 year or even 5 years.
A couple of years ago, Professor Thomas Christensen here at Princeton talked about how the U.S. needs to shape China's rise, and I believe he coined that term, actually. But a question is how. So where in the Chinese policymaking bureaucracy do you think the U.S. policymakers should be focusing their efforts of influence to try to change China's decisions in some of these areas?
So there's all the obvious ways in which, you know, the U.S. is trying to have a much better relationship with the Chinese military to discuss some of these issues. So at least at a very tactical level, they can have a conversation. Sort of two ships run into each other, they know how to communicate. That's one very active area. At the presidential level, there's a very active American push to what the U.S. would love to have is for President Obama and President Xi to have a real conversation about what China wants and what the U.S. wants. You know, they talk about everything in the world except about these sort of core issues. And the U.S. has been desperate to have that kind of honest, strategic conversation with China for years and has never been able to have it. Chinese don't feel confident in having that. They feel that they would be giving away too much if they had it. But it's a very interesting question, and one of my ideas is that actually what the U.S. should be thinking about doing is fostering its own lobby within Chinese industry, within Chinese state-owned companies. And the way I describe that is, in the last few years, China has really played rough with multinational companies, but in the previous 20 years, the single best lobby that China had in the U.S. were American multinational companies that were doing business in China. There was a moment, and I think it was 2008, Hu Jintao went to a Boeing factory at Seattle. And it was the time I'd never seen Hu Jintao smile so much as when he was at this factory in Seattle. The trade union leader there gives a speech, and he put a Boeing hat on Hu Jintao's head. Alan Mulally, who was the vice chairman or deputy chief executive of Boeing, gave a speech saying, China rocks. And there was this great moment. Hu Jintao was just delighted about this. And because he could see that he was this company that was a potential ally, when things got tough, when things got stressed between the US and China, the multinational companies were often the ones who would say, you know, we need to find a way to patch this up, to back down. The US needs to start thinking about building up that kind of constituency amongst big state-owned companies in China, allowing them to invest in this country so that they have a stake in the prosperity and stability of the US, so they are personally tied to the US, so they can play that kind of role in Chinese politics. Because the people who run state-owned companies in China are very important people in themselves, but their next job is probably going to be as one of the senior leaders. And so if you can build up ties with these people can become a potential lobby, a potential ally. But that's very hard politics in the US. Whenever any of these companies try to invest in the US, it immediately becomes a sort of national security issue. It gets kicked to this body called CFIUS that investigates national security links. It gets politicized very quickly. But I think if the US had been smart, it would see that as being, you know, a potential win and not as a threat to have these companies coming in.
Thank you.
Obviously, China's push to become a global hegemon will rely predominantly upon its economic growth. However, a potential issue we've seen recently is that while most of its money comes from the manufacturing industry, a lot of companies have started moving out to other countries due to cheaper labor, so it was just China's main attraction which companies had earlier. Do you believe that will pose a problem for China's economic growth in the long term? And if so, how will China's economy evolve so that it can continue to have economic growth?
That's another fantastic question. China is very rapidly reaching the problem that economists sometimes call the middle income trap. And what they mean by that is there's actually, for a lot of economies, it's been quite easy to have that early stage of rapid growth when you're industrializing and urbanizing, and you get a lot of quick wins. But then it becomes much harder to then push yourself up the value chain. And economies sometimes get stuck at that stage. They're not able to make the next stage into making much more sophisticated goods when they don't become so competitive in that basic stuff. Now, China is a huge economy. It's a very dynamic economy. There will be lots of Chinese companies that are successful that do make that leap. But at an aggregate level, there might be a lot fewer than you might imagine. I mean, it's already striking to me that China is the biggest exporter of manufactured goods in the world. But the non-Chinese people in this room could probably only name two or three Chinese brands. So it's already a big issue, I think, within the Chinese economy that they're struggling to make that leap. So there will be success stories, but they're going to be fewer than I think. And one of the reasons for that is that the innovation system is very clogged up in China. They haven't yet been able to, a lot of it's dominated within state-owned companies. They haven't yet been able to find those very complicated links that you need to have between academia, finance, and industry that are the reason why America has been so successful at that. It's a very hard thing to manage, and few countries have really done it. South Korea is one of the very few ones that's managed it in the last few decades. But it's an incredibly hard thing to do, and China is going to struggle, I think, on an aggregate scale, even though there will be, in 10 years' time, there will be 10 companies we know of, but for an economy of China's size, there should be 100.
Hi, thank you for being here this afternoon. Most of what you've said and the title of your book seems to be premised on the idea that the U.S. and China have a fundamentally competitive and even antagonistic relationship. And I'm wondering if you've accepted this premise and if you think that it's in the U.S. and Chinese interests to accept this premise as well.
So I would draw a big distinction between competitive and antagonistic. Competitive seems to me to be inevitable. There's just the force of events of having these two very large countries with contrasting interests. The trick is to stop that necessarily becoming antagonistic, if you like. That is not necessarily inevitable, although one can't rule it out. And one of the ways I would just think about that is that it seems to me that, you know, in these naval areas, the South China Sea, the East China Sea, this kind of competition is going to be, it's very hardwired, it's very hard to resolve these issues. These countries all have very strong competing claims, and the U.S. is a very powerful interest, why it also wants to be present. So it's inevitable that the U.S. and China is going to be butting up against each other. So the way to think about it to me is that to accept that you're going to have to manage that kind of competition, that's going to be inevitable the next couple of decades. So you need to find new and other ways in which the U.S. and China can work together and cooperate together, not to resolve that competition, but just as a way of providing ballast so that doesn't destroy everything else in the relationship. So far, they've just been relying on these economic interdependencies, but I think you need links between the governments as well that provide habits of cooperation so that there's institutional mechanisms that will prevent them from coming to blows. And that could be all sorts of things. It could be over shale gas, or it could be over the environment, it could be over piracy operations you already see in the Indian Ocean. It could be in Africa, for instance. There's no reason why the US and China couldn't work together in lots of ways in Africa. That would be, in many ways, to both of their interests. It's fatal for the US, I think, to say, well, we have this competition in Asia, so we should transport that to everywhere else in the world. To think that, you know, China is inevitably a competitor of ours in Africa as well, that would be a big mistake if the US goes down that line.
Thank you.
Sir?
I think she's first.
Sure.
You spoke earlier about this division between the doves and the hawks in China, deciding between challenging the U.S. or integrating more fully into the global economic and political order. We also spoke about this idea that the Chinese elite are becoming more responsive to pressure from below. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit more to the extent to which a domestic dialogue could shape the direction of China's ultimate policy, swinging it more towards a dovish approach or to a hawkish approach.
So by and large, that public pressure does seem generally to push China in that more hawkish direction. Now, the interesting question of that is that just because of the nature of the way the media works in China, that you don't have open debate, and so it's all pushing the direction of sort of angry young people on the internet. And if that is, if the people are dominating the discussion, then you will get very angry, resentful views. And so the question about this, the Chinese nationalism is this just a sort of small minority of sort of 10% of people who are very, very angry, and we're just hearing them in a disproportionate way because there's no other way in the media for more moderate and nuanced views to be aired? Or is it in fact that this kind of nationalism, the sort of sense of victimhood, is something that's deeply ingrained in the DNA of the country, and whatever the political system, that would be the sort of dominant voice? That's something we just don't know, but it's one of the most interesting questions. But we would only find out, I think, if the political system was changed.
I'm a retired professor of history, so I do have this historical perspective. I remember there was a time when Ezra Fogel of Harvard wrote his book, Japan is Number One. Right. Well, where's Japan now? But he did emphasize full employment. He did emphasize the emphasis on cleanliness, on orderly conduct, and so on. Now, I don't think you've emphasized enough the weaknesses and vulnerability of China. I can just cite off at least five, six examples. One, the aging population, more and more people getting old. Second, the dissident movements, not mention minorities such as Uyghurs, not mention the Tibetans. I can see the time that if the Dalai Lama should die, there won't be anybody to prevent violence by Tibetans. And I can see that other problems, such as food poisoning, the tremendous foulness in the air, the ill-equipped medical care. Now, I would think the Chinese government would certainly be under pressure from the common people to spend more money instead of abroad, instead of spending on armaments, should be on medical care and education. What I was thinking, too, is the matter of, maybe you can emphasize this, that the U.S. is spreading out too thin. That is to say, just yesterday I read Japan and U.S. signed an agreement, military agreement, expanding the role Japan will have in terms of the Pacific area, and also increasing sale of the most sophisticated armaments to Japan. And Japan is now really violating the Article 9 of the Constitution. But it seems the U.S. is not doing anything about what Abe is doing in terms of repudiation of the peace agreements. I just want to end the fact that it seems to me, in terms of this military competition, China has been also been very reactive, that is to say, you see U.S. officials, including President Obama, going to Burma, Secretary of State going to Vietnam, to Philippines, to drum up support against China. So unless you got to sort of clarify some of these positions, I think the Chinese are trying to perhaps to fend off this encirclement. So that's where I am.
Well, thank you very much. Three very interesting questions. Your first one about Japan, and you mentioned the Ezra Vogel book. I shouldn't be giving a plug to a colleague who's written a book, but a colleague of mine has just written a book about Japan, which, and the title in Japanese is going to be Japan as Number Three. Which will mean an awful lot to people in Japan because they'll exactly get the reference. But it's going through those issues discussing what it means for Japan now to be in this more diminished position and to be behind China. Your first point about, you know, China's weaknesses, they're all exceptionally well-taken points. I completely agree with all of them. And in the very, very long run, if you had a less dynamic China with all these political disturbances and instability, then that sense would be good for the US in as much you'll have fewer resources to put in its military, it will be a less formidable challenger to the US. But over the short to medium term, I think the dynamic is actually the opposite. Because the temptation for the Chinese leadership, if the economy starts to slump, if protests increase, if you have more dissent in the regions, the incentive for the Chinese leadership is actually to push this nationalist agenda. They really felt themselves under threat, what better way to divert attention would be to pick a fight with Japan. That seems to me to be the real risk, is that the Chinese leadership will be pushed into taking a more aggressive stance, especially towards Japan, in order to avoid political problems at home. So the dynamic might actually, the results will actually be sort of in some ways the opposite of what you're implying. Second question about Japan and what the US thinks about Abe. I think they are very worried about some of the nationalist rhetoric, the sort of ways that he, either him or more people around his government, a few cabinet ministers, but also some of the people who are close to Abe, have been calling into question some of these, what people thought were historically settled arguments about Japanese role in the Second World War. They're very worried about the history question. They're not at all worried about what you mentioned about the changes in Japanese military doctrine. On the contrary, they're actively encouraging them. They think these are very good. They think that Japan essentially has way too much of a hair-shirt constitution. It's restrained itself from really being able to do the things it needs to do. And with the kind of things that Abe is proposing, they think are very subtle changes that will just allow Japan to be a little bit more effective. So that, for instance, under Japan's current rules, if, suppose there's a conflict in the Senkaku Daiyu Islands, if a Chinese ship was to attack a Japanese ship, then the US could come to the Japanese ship's aid. If a Chinese ship attacked a US ship, under Japan's self-defense rules, it's not currently allowed to help the American ship. It would have to sort of self-appointed denial that it could do that. So that's one of the little changes that will come out of this new defense guidelines. Just at a functional level, make Japan a little bit more agile and a little bit of a better practical partner. The US doesn't in any way see it as a fundamental revision of Japan's role in the world or anything like militarism. And then finally, on the reactive point, that is precisely how China sees a lot of these things. China thinks a lot of what the US is up to is containment. Some Chinese people, and it goes back to the question, one of the earlier questions, also understand that they have upset some of their neighbors, and that's not necessarily a good thing for them to do, and there are reasons why these countries want to get closer to the US. But the general consensus view within China is the opposite. This is an articulated and coordinated US plan to encircle it. That's one of the unfortunate realities they have to face with, and the US has to find ways to try and pierce through that and to do these things it's doing without seeming too confrontational. Because that's always going to be part of the conversation, but it doesn't want it to become the front of the conversation in China. I don't know if that answers all your questions.
Thank you.
Sir.
Thank you very much for a stimulating talk. You make the point that the conflict must not yield to antagonism. However, the 1,000-pound gorilla in the room has not been addressed, Taiwan. How do you propose the two behemoths should deal with that? And how do you keep that from becoming a point of antagonism?
So one of the curious things about all this story I've outlined about this more assertive China and this Asia that's more worried about China, one of the curious things is that it has happened during a period where actually the relations between China and Taiwan have been probably as good as they've ever been since the foundation of the People's Republic of China. I wouldn't go so far as to say that the problem has been solved, but there is a evolving sort of modus operandi between Taiwan, the People's Republic, and the relationship with the US that has really gathered a lot of pace over the last few years. So that you have a sort of status quo that's really it's become much more stable than people would have thought. And the other interesting part of this is that the sort of Chinese military and naval buildup I've been talking about, one of the interesting bits of it is so much of it is not just about Taiwan anymore. 15 years ago, all of it was about Taiwan. But now China's expanding its interests and expanding its objectives, and it's not just so focused on Taiwan. The final point I'd make, though, is that actually, we've had these protests in Hong Kong the last 2 weeks. It looks as if nothing much will particularly happen in Hong Kong as a result of this process. But I think the big impact will be on sentiment in Taiwan. Because the part and parcel of this sort of rapprochement and greater dialogue with People's Republic in Taiwan has been this idea, on the Chinese side at least, that yes, maybe over time if we have this political dialogue, if economic links grow, that over time we will convince the Taiwanese to come under the the umbrella of the motherland in a similar type of arrangement, another kind of one country, two systems type of arrangement as Hong Kong has. Now, in as much as protests of the last 2 weeks have broken the mystique of one country, two systems, I think the real big impact will be on Taiwan. And you have an election there in 2016. It is possible that that kind of consensus about having a better working relationship with the mainland might start to chip away the edges. Maybe the DPP will gain force. Maybe they'll become more aggressive. That's the thing to watch out, is how the Hong Kong protests seem to play out in Taiwan. But by and large, it's one of the areas I'm actually relatively optimistic about. In an Asian environment that's become much more fragile and potentially unstable, the China-Taiwan-US triangle is the one thing that's got a lot better in